Sitzwella Braverman poured fuel on the flames of national tensions before Saturday's pro-Palestine march. She gave a green light to the morons who came to London on the false pretext the cenotaph was under attack. She effectively told the public they couldn't trust the police. Those who came looking for a fight did so with her apparent blessing. Well, scenes like this were predictable, inevitable, and entirely her fault. Prime Minister Rishi Sunak has been criticised as weak for letting Braverman get away with repeated outbursts that were specifically engineered to cause controversy. Critics say he's risk-averse, managerial, not a leader, but by sacking Braverman and bringing David Cameron back into government, he certainly changed that narrative. And judging by how enraged Labour supporters are about his return, I'd say they probably fear that it's a rather smart move. But if part of the plan was to overshadow Braverman's sacking, well, bad luck. We won't forget that she abandoned her duty to keep this country safe. She was reckless in the extreme to criticise the police ahead of the most controversial public demonstration in years. She had to go, as I said on this show. But that doesn't mean the police or the pro-Palestine supporters are immune to criticism. Last week, I interviewed Douglas Murray. In an exchange that's now been viewed many millions of times around the world, a lot of people focused on this exchange.
OK, well, here's a challenge, Piers. If you decided to go on some kind of march and in week one you discovered that you had the BNP along your side calling, for instance, for the murder of all black people, would you not wonder whether or not you should go on week two? And would you not drop out by about week three? I'd have thought so. I would.
Well, you asked a very pertinent question, and the answer is yes. As I said, I would. Many thousands of people marched peacefully to support Palestine this weekend. They have every right to do so in a democratic country that's serious about free speech. But let's be clear, among those crowds were some hateful racists and blatant anti-Semites. Many people again chanted this.
From the river to the sea!
Palestine will be free! Palestine will be free!
That's unacceptable. From the river to the sea calls for the complete eradication of Israel. If there's any doubt about their intent, listen to this guy.
Why every so many hundred years the Zionists get slaughtered? Because Hitler knew how to deal with these people. They probably made a program so they can create a state of Israel in the expense of Palestinian Muslims' blood.
Well, it's disgraceful, isn't it? Among the crowds, there were many offensive placards. This woman marched proudly around with a Star of David mocked up as a swastika. Another sign showed a Jewish snake suffocating the world, a familiar Nazi trope. These men showed up in Hamas headbands. There were many more examples. We've all seen them. Protesters have every right to demonstrate against Israel's response to the terror attacks on October the 7th. I've said that repeatedly. But we can't allow this unfettered anti-Semitism on our streets. Why didn't other protesters step in to prevent this? Why do the police seem to do nothing besides tweeting about it afterwards? I remember when the police stepped in preemptively to arrest Republican protesters who tried to picket the King's coronation. I didn't think that was right at the time, but if they could be capable of doing that on that occasion, why couldn't they do that to the blatant anti-Semites on this occasion, some of whom were obviously glorifying terrorists? And that is a crime in this country. Well, I'm joined now by the broadcaster and former editor of the Sunday Times, Andrew Neil. Andrew, so much to talk about, so little time to talk about it. But let me just get your take, first of all, on the bombshell news today, which we thought was going to be Sitzwella Braverman getting fired, but also the extraordinary comeback of David Cameron. What's your response to this?
Well, the government's had trouble getting middle-aged men who lose their jobs back into the labour force, so this is an example that shows it can be done. But in addition to that, I think it's... Look, the Tory gene pool is pretty depleted, and David Cameron has stature and experience and recognition. He will add to the weight of a cabinet that is pretty lightweight. He brings a wealth of experience in foreign affairs to the job. As Prime Minister, he knows a lot and learned a lot about foreign affairs, because foreign affairs these days is run inside 10 Downing Street, probably even more than it is in the Foreign Office. People, not just foreign ministers around the world will see him, but prime ministers and presidents will see him. So it's a good high-profile appointment for the government. Will it make any difference politically? Is it a game changer? No, it won't, I don't think. It may reassure a few swithering Tories in the blue wall that they haven't, the government hasn't given up on them, but it isn't going to affect the result of the election. There is no election in British democratic history that has been affected by who the Foreign Secretary is.
What about the removal of Suella Braverman? Does that denote that Rishi Sunak, A, wants to instill authority on his cabinet, and she clearly breached that authority, but secondly, that he's moving the party perhaps slightly more to the centre and is not so bothered anymore about appeasing the right wing of the party?
Well, I think the idea that Rishi Sunak was on the right of the party was always mistaken. He's basically a non-ideological technocrat and a fiscal conservative. Which is what David Cameron was, George Osborne, his chancellor, was too. He's pretty much in the mainstream of conservative thinking. I think the main reason wasn't even ideological with Suella Braverman. I mean, you know, Linton Crosby, the great Australian election strategist, said that politicians have got to realise they're not pundits. That's your job, Piers, and my job. Mm. We're not politicians, we're pundits. Mm. They're not pundits, they're politicians. And Suella Braverman had basically become a pundit.
Yeah.
Rather than running the Home Office, doing something about what was concerning her, she was writing articles for the Times and giving interviews. No prime minister can tolerate that for long. Mr. Sunak is not thought to be a strong leader, so he had to show the smack of firm government in making a change. And he did as soon as he got the Remembrance weekend out of the way.
Talking about that weekend, the big pro-Palestinian march, obviously there were a bunch of yobs who turned up as well, which was entirely predictable, I think, after all the incendiary rhetoric of the few days before. But putting that to one side, there's general agreement that their behaviour was appalling. What do we do about big marches, 300,000 people, it's estimated here, where the majority of them are genuinely marching, it appears, peacefully and for peace? They want a ceasefire in Gaza, but they are joined by a not insignificant number of people who are blatantly spewing anti-Semitic tropes or chants or pro-Hamas regalia in some cases. What do we do about this?
Well, I think it was a pity that the march took place on Saturday, but I wouldn't have banned it and didn't want to ban it. In the end, the right to protest is a democratic right, and that's a right that can be exercised whether we approve or disapprove. Indeed, it's easy to approve of protesters who are protesting things of which we approve. It's more difficult, but more important, to allow them to protest when they're protesting of things that we don't approve of. So if the organisers really wanted it to go ahead, I think it was a right to allow it to go ahead. I don't think they did their cause any good. It wasn't necessary to have done it on Saturday. There's been four marches already. There are plenty of weekends to come between now and Christmas to have more, but that was their choice. And the main violence, the main yobbish behaviour came from the hard right, who turned up around the Cenotaph and Downing Street area. They were the real thugs there. However, there was an element to that march, to the pro-Palestine march, which was very unsavoury. And you touched on it in your monologue at the beginning. And I think, you know, there's a right to protest, but protesters also have obligations. And their obligation is to stay within the law and within the bounds of democratic legitimacy and proper protest. And I'm afraid anti-Semitism and race hatred and shouting jihad in a clear context of wiping Israel out is not acceptable. And the police will need to get much tougher on that and leave the bulk of the peaceful demonstrators to get on exercising their democratic rights.
Yep, completely agree. Andrew Neil, as always, I concur. Thank you very much indeed for joining me.
Thank you. I appreciate it.